Senator Reid. Senator Wicker.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. This is a vitally important hearing. Thank you for calling it. Senator Reid, thank you for emphasizing the importance of NATO and to the extent that your question reemphasizes our commitment as a Senate and as a Congress to that vital alliance. I want to associate myself with those sentiments. I do want to ask, get back to the China question. Yesterday, the Justice Department unsealed sweeping criminal charges against Huawei. Violation of U.S. sanctions, as well as outright intellectual property theft. I want to offer into the record at this point, Mr. Chairman, an op-ed from today's Wall Street Journal, the 5G promise and the Huawei threat, authored by former House Intel Chairman Mike Rogers.
Without objection.
Chairman Rogers says this in the second sentence of his op-ed, Huawei's behavior is finally being recognized for what it is. So help us, Mr. Ratner and Mr. Kobe, understand what China is up to with regard to Huawei and, to a lesser extent, ZTE. Mr. Ratner, you mentioned on page 4 of your testimony a comprehensive strategy that includes a lot of things, military, economics, diplomacy, ideology, and technology. Is that what you're talking about here? And Mr. Kobe, you talk about the enemy's theory of victory. Is dominance of this new 5G level of just very advanced technology going to be part of China's theory of victory? Mr. Ratner first.
Thank you, Senator. I would look at the Huawei issue through 4 separate lenses. The first being the legal. Of course, the company is engaged, and this is what the indictment was about, is engaged in illegal activities, stealing trade secrets, obstructing a criminal investigation, evading sanctions, and ought to be dealt with from a law enforcement capacity. That's the first lens to view this through. The second is through the security lens, which I think is what you're primarily referencing here, and,
right,
and the threat it poses to supply chains, critical infrastructure. That's absolutely real. We know that the Huawei leadership has members of the Communist Party within it, and the company has long and deep relationships with both the PLA and the Ministry of State Security in China, and of course is subject to Chinese law and their new national intelligence law, which gives the government the right to use the networks and data as they wish. Third, I would look at the Huawei issue through the lens of, separate from its functionality, but through the lens of China's unfair trade and investment practices, which our country still is on the wrong side of, to the extent that we don't have access to their markets and they have access to ours, and we ought to think about a principle of reciprocity. And then finally, the overall technology competition. So these are all coming together within the Huawei issue, and they all merit a response. We need defensive measures. And we need to invest in our own technologies as well, and we need to be cooperating with allies and partners. So the technology competition, I think, stretches across the military and the economic and requires a comprehensive response.
Mr. Colby.
Thank you, Senator Wicker, and I agree with Dr. Ratner on this, as so many other points. I would say I think it absolutely is part of their overall theory of victory, which is to do, I think, a couple of things. One is to generate the leverage within various countries that could be part of this alliance or partnership architecture that would be designed to check Chinese aspirations to dominate the region and potentially beyond. And things like Huawei will give them economic leverage, informational leverage, I mean, blackmail leverage, et cetera, you know, bribery we've seen in places like Sri Lanka. This dissolves or corrodes the resolve in these countries potentially to stand up to Chinese potential coercion. And then there's also the sentiment, I think, that, you know, maybe the world is going China's way, as they used to say about the Soviets in the 70s, that, you know, maybe we better just go with the Chinese. And I think that's why these countries, some of them allies, many of them, you know, kind of partners, not traditional allies, are really the center of gravity, because we need to work with these countries not in a sort of charity-motivated way, but we need to be able to form a network that together is sufficiently cohesive to stand up to these Chinese efforts.
Is the national defense strategy adequate in discussing this issue?
I think absolutely, sir. I think it can be made, the point can be made more robustly and more eloquently by people like this body and political leaders, so the American people see that these alliances are sort of enlightened self-interest, not sort of charity. And I think that's a different way that maybe we can start talking about these alliances, that it's a sort of almost like a business enterprise, that we share these broad interests. But, you know, that involves our allies doing more and contributing more. But really, we're doing this in our own interest to prevent the Chinese from dominating East Asia in particular.
Thank you.